as a hitman took place in an alley in Detroit.
I wanted to see his expression on his face that he had slipped, and I wanted to let him know, you out of there.
Robbing banks was little more than a pastime.
I would go in the bank, get a lady the note, and just to see the expression on her face, you know, it was just an easy rip.
Before his 25th birthday, he was leading the most notorious drug trafficking ring in Detroit history. At its height, Young Boys Incorporated, as the gang was known, was grossing $100,000 a day.
I had to have it. It was like oxygen to me. I can't breathe without no money.
Here was live, right? It was live as hell, man. I mean, you could always come up and down this motherfucker here and do whatever you wanted to do.
They used to say back in my day, if you wasn't from Linwood, you wasn't about nothing.
12th Street was booming. Dexter was booming. You know, this was electrifying time. You know, you had the hustlers, but there was a code of honor. Mm-hmm. Children were very, they were considered very special. During that period, most kids went to church.
You could always go to somebody's house, you know what I mean? Get something to eat or whatever, you know, watch television, spend the night, whatever.
Detroit's very unique. You could be on one block, for example, where the Gordy Mansion was. You'd be there on the corner there where the Gordy Mansion was. You go one block over, two blocks over, and you had Calvert, which was a working class street. Berry Gordy, where the mansion was upper class.
It was open, you know, a lot of stores. People had different things going on in Destin.
And the restaurant was right there on the corner of Destin and Duane. You know what I mean? Monster Burger. You could always go in there and get you a burger or a slice of cake.
There was so much money over there, man. It was unreal.
It was all gravy. This used to be one of the favorite spots, the Dexter Bar. You come here, man, everybody's here. You know, they shooting pool, having a nice time, you know what I mean? And everybody was always out here.
Okay, my name is Delbert McCoy. That's D-E-L-B-E-R-T, capital M-C-C-O-Y. The Fantastic Four were singing there. That was Sweet James. They did The Whole World's a Stage. Pretty good group. Everybody liked them. And then there was a guy that I went to school with named Jimmy Edwards from the Superlatives. They were doing something down there that night also. So we, you know, went there, sit around, had a couple of drinks. Mingle with the people we went to school with. You know, you had to, it was like a staircase. You entered the door, and then you had to walk up the staircase to enter the dance hall. Just before I entered the door, a guy told me, he said, man, I wouldn't go in there. It's going to be a problem down there. But I saw no indication of something happening down there. And so I paid no attention to him, which I had, but I didn't pay attention. I opened the door and went in. No sooner than I got in, I would say within seconds, the door, a gasoline can came in, and then another guy lit a match.
On July 23rd, 1967, Detroit was hit by a riot. We said it couldn't happen here. Things were too good. But it did, and the nation was shocked. This is a portion of the story of that riot which left 43 dead, thousands injured, and a city in flames. These films tell a part of that story.
I was on Monterey. I participated in the riots, you know. It was like come up. They had a lot of stores and stuff up on deck. And we went in and got a lot of groceries, clothes, TV sets, things of this nature.
Mommy's on her knees, she had tears in her eyes, and her body knew why the young girl had to die. People look ashamed.
That was the beginning of the end, in my opinion. From there we went, it got worse. That changed everything. That was the pivotal change.
The two officers were southbound on Woodward when they spotted a group of young men on the corner of Leicester and block north of Northern High School. It was just the situation they were sent out to check on. They pulled a U-turn and stopped to write tickets for curfew violations. As they approached the youths, a young man came forward and fired two shots. One struck Officer Green in the head, the other striking Byers in the chest. Although the youth scattered, three of them were arrested shortly after the incident.
Through the cooperation of citizens of the city and intensive work by members of the Homicide Special Crime Section, we have in custody several people. One of the arrested persons, Gary Goings, have been arrested for the murder of Officer Green. And he is being charged with murder first degree, also murder with assault to attempt to commit murder, and possession of firearm while in custody of while committing a felony.
Officer Green died this morning at 8:14. Officer Byers is listed in serious condition at Ford Hospital.
By the time Milton Jones was 15, he had reached a level of illegal activity and violence that only the hardest of criminals know. When he started his drug empire in 1978, police officials say Young Boys Incorporated, as his gang was known, controlled 80% of the heroin traffic in Detroit. The gang was also implicated in 68 homicides. After spending 16 years in state and federal prisons, Milton Jones says his drug dealing days are behind him. He's pushing a new product now, his life story, and that's where the controversy begins.
I just felt like my mother, my father, you know, it was tight for us. And I knew they couldn't afford the things that I wanted, you know, the gym shoes, the leather jackets, and things of this nature, you know, the gator shoes, just things they just couldn't afford. And it was five of us living here, and it would just been selfish of me for them to try to buy me a $90 pair of shoes or something of that nature, you know. And so I turned to crime. People that I was running with was committing crimes, you know, and I just kind of fell into the groove. You know, I started emulating what I seen.
You didn't start off with heroin right away, did you? Get started in crime?
I started skipping school, missing school, you know, and just things was available, you know. I remember one time the taxi cab driver, Dexter and Dwayne, they used to be, all the cabs used to come up there. It was like, that was the Monster Burger. And at that particular time, the cab driver used to keep their money in a cigar box. The cab driver get out the cab, he go in the Monster Burger. So me and my man Ricky, we just seen the opportunity, and it was like, we gonna get that cab driver. He went in, we got his money out of the cab, started running down the street hollering "Rip." It was an opportunity, and we seen it, and it just started like that, you know.
Yeah, me and Butch Young, we grew up young. Stuff, man, new in the hood, man. Just messing around as young guys, man.
Well, we grew up, man, it wasn't that bad. It was lovely around here when I was growing up, you know what I mean? My brother, he was always a go-getter, you know what I mean? If we didn't have enough for Christmas, he made sure that we did, you know?
Well, me and Baby grew up together, so little guy, come on, we were always gonna be cool. Butch used to come over and pick brother up, and we shoot slingshots and BB guns and shit. And when he got in the game, some came up missing. He, after that, he ain't fucking with me no more. See what I'm saying? We had just got in, man. I think we flipped like two packs. Then after that, some of that, everything kind of crashed and died.
There was a bunch of petty crimes, things of this nature, you know. And So I started buying clothes, parka sweaters, you know, gabardine pants and suede jackets, leather jackets, you know. This is a lot of material stuff, you know, but at that point, I knew I couldn't come in here and ask my mother and father to buy it for me.
Which my dad was a hell of a provider, you know what I mean? But my brother, he always doing the extras, you know what I mean? And everybody around the neighborhood loved him, you know what I mean? I mean, everybody wanted to be like him.
I started doing things. I just stopped going to school altogether, and I started working for my brother-in-law, selling penny caps, which was heroin at that particular time, you know? And I believe when he taught me the game, he didn't know that I was going to elevate the game to the level that I did. You know, I feel like he was trying to do something for me to keep me off the streets, so to speak, because I was out here doing a lot of petty crime.
Gaining a reputation in the underworld usually comes by committing heinous crimes. In Butch Jones' words, it's called earning your bones. Jones moved up the ranks swiftly. By his 16th birthday, to his list of credits, Jones added a spree of bank robberies, a shotgun murder while guarding a drug house, and finally, murder for hire. In an alley like this, he hid in a dumpster, waiting for his victim to empty his trash as he did every morning at the same time. Little did he know, this would be the last time he would make the trip.
Tell me about the hit, the first hit.
A guy come to me, he knew I had heart. And he was like, man, I'm gonna give you $20,000. I need this guy dealt with. I was like, you must want the president shot or somebody. And that's the way I looked at it, you know. I said, $20,000. And I went on and laid on in the garbage. And when he came out that morning, I shot him. I went to dude, got my other $10,000. It was just business. Wasn't nothing personal, it was just business.
You talked a little bit about looking at the guy's face. You talked about the look in his eye.
Yeah.
That meant something to you. Why is that?
Because I was told that this guy was a real tough guy. So I said, okay, and I wanted to see his expression on his face, that he had slipped. And I wanted to let him know, you out of there, you know? So I looked him right in the face and I wanted to see his expression. You know, and the expression he had on his face, he was like, damn. It was like, you know, like you drop something on your pants. You're like, damn. Oh, you know you done messed up. And that's the kind of expression he had on his face.
Butch, we're in Highland Park, Michigan. This was a place that has a particular significance as it relates to your criminal career. What happened here in Highland Park on Richmond Street in Hamilton in that apartment building across the street?
It was back in the summer of 73. I was sitting on my mama's porch. I didn't have really nothing to do, just chilling. And my homeboy, Pahu, come and asked me if I had a gun. So I was like, yeah, I had a gun. What's up? And he told me that somebody had just robbed Leroy's sister, which Leroy was my man. Leroy and Robert Jr. was my man. They was in my crew, you know. So I tell him, I said, well, do the people know me? He said, no. I said, well, let me go with you. It was like me, Pahu, Kathy, and Leroy. And we gone up. I'm the last one to come in. I let Kathy knock on the door. And when she knocked on the door, We just came on in the place. So I asked her, did she see the guy that had robbed her, took her money? And she was like, no, it was just two people up there. We searching the place trying to see if her money is up there. And at the same time, this guy, he gets up, and I guess this guy had no karate or something. He wanted to try to throw some karate on me. So, and I'm telling the guy all the time, I said, look, we ain't come for you, and I ain't trying to hurt you or nothing. Man, just please, just sit down and let us try to get this girl's money back. So now this guy, all of a sudden, just kept trying to do some karate on me, and I hadn't pulled the pistol out, and I'm letting him know, I'm serious, man, I ain't coming, I ain't trying to hurt you, just sit down. And all of a sudden, I don't know if this guy was high or whatever, he just kept doing this karate thing, and I end up shooting the guy in the leg because I don't want to hurt this guy. But the same token, I don't want him to hurt me or kick the gun out of my hand or something like this. So when I shoot the guy, my man Robert Jr. just come out of the room and just went wild. He just went to stabbing the guy. He just went to stabbing. So now this thing is out of hand now, man.
The guy that you shot in the leg and who subsequently ended up getting stabbed by your partner died.
He died.
And you went to prison because this was now murder.
Right. And what really actually saved me is when the lady who testified up there testified that she told the whole story just like I told it to you, but I kept trying to tell the guy I didn't want to do nothing to him, you know, and that the guy came out and started stabbing him and wanted to kill her and the baby, and I wouldn't let him. And this is how the judge ended up letting me, convicted me of manslaughter.
Jones was convicted of manslaughter for the killings at Richton and Hamilton. He served 4.5 years. Instead of going straight, upon his release, Jones put together the most prolific drug organization in the country at that time. He handpicked hardcore criminals from his neighborhood to create the nucleus of Young Boys Incorporated.
We came from Hogar and Lawton, me and a couple of my homeboys. Came down here one day and seen all these young guys with top 10s on and Adidas tracksuits. We was like, damn, what the fuck is happening? So we wanted to get some of that money, and we introduced ourselves. He said, y'all want to get some money? He put us down right down here, man. We was rolling right here on Monterey and Dexter, Richton and Dexter, right here. This is where I first met Bushman, man, right here, and started getting money. This is where Young Boys originated from, right down here on Dexter.
Younger people, you know, looking successful, you know, having a couple dollars, whatever, you know.
But see, it was like younger boys from here down on this end, young boys from that end, young boys from Linwood, and all Bush did was made one set, you know, with one group. He said, fuck all this warring and fighting among each other, we just make one set. Made them all YBI.
Young Boys originated in the middle 70s, and basically it originated in the 10th Precinct area.
Deputy Police Chief Nathaniel Topp worked the special investigation squad back in the late 70s when Young Boys Incorporated was starting out.
They amassed a small workforce, or excuse me, a large workforce of youngsters, teenagers, individuals in their 20s and 30s that would literally go into an area, say for instance, that was controlled by the traditional older dope dealers, and just by the sheer numbers of 20, 30, 40, and 50 individuals would just saturate a particular 3-4 block area and basically run off the competition.
YBI meant everything, man. That's what a nigga wanted to be. Them niggas was rich, they were successful, they had all the hoes, they had all the money, all the cars. Who didn't want to be that, man?
Everybody throw the beaters on, campaign hats and shit on, you know.
You know what I'm saying? With the top 10s, the low-cut suede McAdoo's.
People was running up to us like we was the stars, like we was stars. We was signing autographs. We got in free. We didn't, the tickets we had, we just threw them on the ground. The people let us right in. I remember when I was 13, going to Mick Michael Middle School, going to school in limos, having a limo wait outside for me all day. Until I got out of school, me and my girl going to restaurants at the age of 12, 13 going down to the Renaissance Center staying for 2-3 weeks at a time, paying $200 a night.
Whatever you was doing, you still looked up to them, because no matter where you was at or what you was doing, they was getting more money than you, period.
My brother, he brought me on this block, man. I seen all them guys bouncing that Rick James, that young boys growing up in the ghetto.
Butch, how did a young guy get into Young Boys Incorporated? What was the procedure?
Well, basically, if you wasn't from this neighborhood and you wanted to roll, you wanted to be down, you had to get somebody to sponsor you. In other words, somebody had to vouch for you that you was a stand-up guy, meaning that you wouldn't tell if you got caught.
He was a big dope man, and we used to always wonder, why is all these Benzes and Cadillacs and big trucks and all kind of cars? We thought that he was a movie star, but as years went on and come to find out, he was one of the biggest dope men in the city.
Notorious. Notorious dog. Really?
Notorious, yeah.
Everybody wanted to be Butch at once upon a time, you know, because he was that guy, you know? He was the man.
Nobody was more powerful than Butch, you know?
He was some people's god. I mean, you know what I'm saying? Put it like that. You know, every day was like school, you know what I'm saying? That's all he's doing is teaching me stuff. Very smart, he man, dude on point. He definitely taught me stuff that no other father would, you know, teach a kid, you know. And I thank him for that too.
Doug, all I know is he the dude that put it down. All I know is you see Butch, you see a whole lot of money. That was it. That's all I remember about Butch.
You had guys doing anything and everything that he wanted done, you know, and it wasn't no, you wasn't gonna do it, because if they didn't do it, you know, they would end up dead, you know?
The hook was to try to recruit at an early age so you could mainstream these young kids into the organization. So by the time they were 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, they were aware of the mechanism. You know, they had on-the-job training.
He would buy young guys top 10, Levi's, silk shirts. You know, then they seen Butch riding around in Benz and Cadillacs. You know, they liked that. You know, even me today, I grew up watching guys who was gangbangers and dope dealers. You know, I grew up having a good life. My father always worked at Ford Motor Company. We never had warning for nothing as kids, but it was just something excited me about, you know, guys making money.
In Detroit, big money in the pockets of small boys has the attention of federal investigators.
Young dealers can make up to $800 a day, possess an arsenal of weapons, and readily kill to protect their turf and profits. The smallest confrontation can become a matter of life and death.
Detroit police say they see this less as a crime problem than as a drug problem.
The New York Times reported today that authorities are trying to crack drug rings, paying the boys thousands of dollars to work as runners, distributing heroin to addicts. One 11-year-old was arrested with $2,000 in his pockets. And one auto dealer said a 15-year-old bought a Mercedes-Benz recently.
I was 12 years old.
Hey, when I got recruited, I was 15 years old. Wasn't no jail, you go straight to juvenile.
Yeah, that's what young boys stood for, Young Boys Incorporated. Wasn't no old niggas out here selling dope. The old guys ran it, you know. But the young guys, we was out here taking all the risks every day.
These men were millionaires. Young boys saw that. They could touch that. They said, I want to be Memphis Slim.
That's what it was. It was Butch getting a lot of young guys together, knowing that when they got busted, they couldn't go to jail. Most of the time, they was released back to their parents. So it was easy for him. He never had to pay no bond. You know, none of that. That's what it meant. Young Boys Incorporated, exactly what them words stood for.
They probably was making about few thousand dollars a day, you know. That still was a lot of money for a 13-year-old kid, man, who couldn't go to jail. When the police came and picked him up, you know, you can't go to jail, you ain't finna go to jail, you know what I'm saying? They gonna let you loose to your parents. You know, that's how Butch got all that money, man. He had these young guys out here selling dope, knowing they couldn't go to prison, couldn't go to jail, man.
With the YBI, if you had a brother who was 12 or 13 or 14 years old and they wanted your brother to come and work for you, to, you know, say, hey, you're going to work for me, and they refused, then they would shoot them down in the street. So it was a fear, either you come and work or either you die if they wanted you to sell drugs for them.
It all goes on routinely. It's commonplace in many areas of Detroit. Young people are on the street selling heroin. Here's Butch, 20 years old, recovering from a heroin addiction that began when he was 17, and he started buying dope from Young Boys Incorporated.
I've copped dope from kids as young as 8, 9 years old off of Dwayne and Dexter.
The kids work in teams, one collecting the money, another delivering the dope, others acting as lookouts, and all are decoys for one another. And when a lookout throws a signal, a busy street can become deserted in a matter of seconds. That way, a cruising police officer sees nothing. And when they are caught, sources tell me the adult drug dealer will give his young runners all the protection money can buy.
A lot of the bigger dope men, they make it a practice of letting them know if they take care of the heroin sales on the street, or if they're a good worker, that they'll come to their rescue anytime they get in any trouble with the police or get caught with heroin on the street.
As a result, Young Boys Incorporated has expanded into Pontiac, where police say the group has been connected with at least one murder. And they're reportedly recruiting in the schools, like McKenzie High on the West Side, where school officials are quoted as saying they're worried about the student body being infiltrated. All in all, police say Young Boys Incorporated is responsible for at least 20% of all the heroin sold in Detroit. In fact, police say the group is taking in an incredible $250,000 a day.
We confiscated one day's receipts from one location. They had more than one location. It was $23,000 that we could document from one day's take.
Allegations came back time and time again that Butch Jones was using underage preteens to sell heroin to people on the streets. You denied that. Did you ever use kids who were younger than teenagers?
No, they was teenagers, but like 15, 16. The part that, which I still deny because it's not true. I never had nobody 8 or 9 years old selling heroin. There's not nobody in the drug game 8, 9 years old.
You lived in the neighborhood, you were going to be pressured into it, or families, it was not uncommon for families to move their kids out, their young men out of the neighborhoods because of the pressures were just too demanding on them.
Basically, I let a guy know that we was rolling and that we was serious. And I was like, look, this ain't no nickel and dime operation. This ain't the Boy Scouts or nothing like that. This is serious, and this, if you serious about getting some money, I'm serious about getting some money.
I mean, if you think about it, it was an ingenious idea. If you have juveniles carrying drugs around, they can't go. In those days in particular, they couldn't go to adult prison. In those days, they didn't have automatic waiver. And they'd go to juvenile court, and what are they going to do to them? You know, the kids were making money, I guess. It was attractive. Streets were attractive. I had never heard anything like that you're going to send. I mean, if you think about it, it's about as ruthless as you can be. And for grown men to take kids, out of 7th and 8th grade and give them dope and put them in cabs and have them go stand on a street corner in Lawton or something and sell and then let them start out their life with two juvenile convictions for drug dealing. But, I mean, it's ingenious from the money aspect. It's just, a bit ruthless to me.
By 1980, Jones and his gang are making money faster than they can count it. YBI has grown from a select few from Jones' neighborhood to a few hundred. The gang reached a level of sophistication never before attained by an urban drug gang. YBI starts a national trend, moving boldly to the street corners, selling heroin openly, daring the police to catch them.
You said you did $20,000 a day heroin traffic out of this neighborhood.
Off the street.
Off this street.
Right.
Just this one or two block stretch.
Right. Just this one block stretch.
How do you do that?
Well, basically, we had tight security, and it was our stronghold, so to speak. You know, this is where the young boys was from. We was from Martindale, and we was from Dexter, And
how did you have the security set up?
Well, I had a man down on the corner with a walkie-talkie, and I had one down there on the corner with a walkie-talkie. And that was the only two ways the police could come. Either they can come from Corlin or they can come from Amherst. And that was it. And by the time somebody hollered off the hook, we out of here. We bailed. So basically it was nothing they could do. We always stayed supplied. We were never out. And the customers knew that. They knew if they came over here, it was going to always have something.
You might do it like dog do it. Dog, give him 4, he put him 3. Dog, we get him like this. Well, what if I got to do, I do yo. Dog was getting his money. He came up in the game fast. I wish my man would have just laid on back with his money. See what I'm saying?
At the age of 12 years old, I was making $7,000 to $8,000 a day. At 12, at the age of 12. Having fun, man. Going to wheel skate ring, throwing money away so that people can fight in the crowd. Throwing $300-$400 worth of ones in the air. Just having fun back then, man. That's what it was really all about.
Go to the concert, any big event, and I was able to get in, Never was broke, shopping every day, at least 5 times a week. I take my friends shopping,
like a crew.
Together, we can get paid and paid and paid.
Most money I ever had saved up was $270,000 cash. I was 15 years old. I had $270,000. I used to wake up in the middle of the night and play with it, throw it up in the air, and roll around. And, you know, never had a car. Was too young to buy anything. I mean, what you gonna do with $270,000 at the age of 15? You know, I had a deal. And Nike lined all the way around my roar.
Man, on their way out to little Cedar Point, man, 20 events back to back, campaign hats, motherfucking Adidas track suits, you know, throwing the ponies out the window because they ain't fucking pony now. 100,000 here, 100,000 there, you know, doing their thing, man. Everybody was living real good, man, period.
At one time, probably about 20 or 30 guys, man, or maybe more than that, Flip. 20, 30 people, man, used to be out here rolling all day, sun up to sundown. $80,000 a day being made right here on this corner, man. Just on this area right here, you know, $100,000 a day, man. It was worth selling dope. Now you can't make that kind of money.
All them guys, man, them guys were like amazing, man. You know, besides the rap cast, it was the only niggas that was really getting money, you know? And as a kid, watching them niggas, that's what I wanted to do when I grew up, you know? You look up, you got 20, 30 vets on the block and shit, you know? Niggas with all kind of stacks, whipping up, giving you 100, 200, 300 here and there, man. What can you do but want to do that, man? No matter what school do for you.
How did you set up a stakeout on the corner when you were going to deal? Tell me the players who were there and how you dealt with the stash.
Well, basically, it would be about four of us that would work a spot. We'd take the bundles and say, for instance, if I put them over there in the corner, and I got one person there, that's his job is to watch that. I got another person on the corner, he looking out for the police. I got another person, he running to the customer. I want two packs, three packs, whatever the case may be, and I got another person, he's security. He just making sure that we don't get robbed and nothing like that. And it basically takes four people to work a spot.
YBI controlled at least 80% of the narcotic trafficking in the city of Detroit. Prior to 1984 and before the first indictment of Young Boys, Detroit was second only to New York for the consumption of heroin.
2 p.m. at Woodrow Wilson in Cortland on Detroit's west side. Watch the teenager in the blue jacket as he approaches the car, throws a signal by holding up two fingers, and finally waves the car in. A moment later, a second youngster approaches the car and apparently makes a delivery. The car drives away, and the teenager in the blue jacket passes the money he's received to the runner who made the delivery. Now we're at Joy Road in Petoskey, another well-known center of heroin trafficking back on the west side, and this time it's high noon. Young people and teenagers are out on the streets stopping cars, apparently making sales right under our nose, and hollering out what police say are brand names of heroin, like Whipcracker.
Murder One, the Whipcracker, the P-Funk, that's Young Boys. Them are stamp brands, you know. Murder One, you know what I'm saying? We had all type of killer dope, you know?
Who's your convey? Motherfuckers all over there in the projects. From the east side coming over here, get some that Hoochie Khan.
Hoochie Khan, Murder One, that P-Funk!
Run a Hoochie Khan, Murder One, China White. You know what I'm saying? Get served, you know? We like that. That's how it went down. I mean, it would be cars from here to the, way over there, to that next bandit building over there, man. And that's how we got on, Flip. It was gravy, man. It was a lovely situation out here.
Yeah, they said it was a big business. You know what I mean? Said it was getting plenty of money. How they was doing that, you know, cutting with Lato. Yeah, they said it was a big business.
We used to have lookouts. It was a big building right here. We used to have lookouts all through the buildings. We used to pay guys to watch the corners right here, all the way down to Cortland, all the way down to Broad Street.
Street Richardson. He would have all the lieutenants pull up in Unity and City Cabs. They would get their dope and distribute the dope among the workers, you know, them in the morning. You know, Young Boys didn't roll all day. They rolled from like 7 to 5, 7 in the morning to 5. Their day was done. You know, they didn't sell dope all day.
I say at least about maybe 500, 600 bottles a day on Dexter
and Richland. We would do about 100 right here on Martindale. We'd do about 200-300 on DeWayne. Some places we would do even more, man. It all depends on, you know, what area you in. Projects, oh, we do the projects up, man.
They never got the dope from the person who they gave the money to. Like, they would give the money to me, and then I would tell them, well, this guy gonna come back and bring their dope. But they never seen that guy.
It was about the money. Everybody that was down with me, we all had the same vision. We wanted money. When YBI became YBI as far as public was concerned, man, we was bigger than life at that particular time. You know, I'm getting $100,000 a day. I'm hooking up 24 hours a day. I got three different spots where we hooking up at. You know, I'm running through a Kia Heron every day, and I'm making more money, man, than the president. I'm really living the American dream. I got four or five houses in the suburbs. I got every kind of car that you can imagine, you know. So now at this time, I'm really looking at, like, the government, you know. I can't go to jail. I got money. My crew, I got power, man. I got power you couldn't believe of, you know. So in my head, I'm feeling like as long as I don't get caught with the drugs, I'm not going to jail. You couldn't have told me I was going to jail.
You looked at the way money was made in America, and you said to yourself, criminals built America.
And I believe that.
Criminal enterprise made America strong in the money department and in the international political arena.
Yeah.
So why not use crime to get my slice of the American dream? Does that rationale really work?
Work for the kidneys.
Man, I helped him come, man. He said it was $5 million. Yeah. Like every night when he come home, you know, he bring the garbage bag for the money, and we sit in the living room and count. You know, he's telling me to keep all the singles. I'm just gonna count because I know these singles, man. You know what I'm saying? The fives. So, you know, but it'll be big ass industrial bags every night. We sit right in the living room floor. I couldn't wait. You know, I had shoe boxes full of singles, you know, just singles, singles everywhere, singles.
There's a social theorist, Robert Merton, talks about if you can't get the American dream the American way, which is really a fallacy, then you will go and get it any way you can.
We didn't want to hurt nobody or nothing like that, but if it came to it, we dealt with it accordingly.
You know, this Martindale. This was known as Martindale Killers. There ain't nothing but killers come up off Martindale.
Dexter was known for killing. You get killed on Dexter quick.
You sell drugs, this is how you regulate. You do not have a Wall Street. You don't have a regulatory body. So competition fights over blood money. And I knock you out in order to sell my goods. And you're correct, it destroys the people. It destroys everything. It's a very destructive force.
Them boys was there. Wasn't no joke, you know what I'm saying?
When we bust a spot open, when I say bust a spot open, where I go and I set up shop, the first thing I would do is I go in the neighborhood and I feel the neighborhood out and I talk to people, because I always came with love. I always came where it ain't going to be no violence. But on the same token, I let a person know, now, I'm coming to you. Now, the next guy that I send, he's not going to talk. He's going to be some action. He gonna bring the drama.
With the upper echelon of young boys, when they were trying to exact some retribution, we had a killing. I can't think of the individual's name, but there was a delicatessen off of Dexter where they exacted some brutal punishment. I mean, they wanted you to know they were out there. They didn't kill in secrecy all the time. They would do it publicly. They wanted that corpse to be a lesson to those who would try to take over or move into young boys' territory. Living day by day in my hood
on the spot. See the same old thing, same dope things, cops. Today, still wanted by the government, they survive as soldiers of fortune. If you have a problem, if no one else can help, and if you can find them, maybe you can hire the A-Team.
YBI, you was gonna respect YBI.
The A-Team was a hit squad. That was their job. They killed people who either messed up money or who wouldn't allow Bush to come on Corner to Rose.
Oh, man. Nothing but cold killers.
I can say if you wasn't fucking around, it wasn't scary for you. But you was out here fucking up, better watch your head, cuz. Period.
You had to really, really do something, man, to get killed. You know?
This summer has been especially violent, with more than 500 shootings reported in 2 months. FBI figures show Detroit with 61 murders for every 100,000 citizens last year. Gary, Indiana was second, and other major cities ran far behind. Drugs and guns are a deadly mixture, and together they've given Detroit the highest murder rate of any American city.
This is a war. This is an epidemic. I've been to Vietnam, but this is a war right here. This is our Vietnam.
When I came and I introduced myself, I said, I'm Bush Jones. And I tell a person, you know, I'm coming to put it down. If y'all want to get some money, y'all can get on my team. Now, if you told me, you ain't rolling over here and blah, blah, splee, I said, okay, thank you. Have a nice day. Now, when you looked up, the next time somebody was coming, they was coming to wreck you.
Guys would jump out of vans with baseball bats and tear you up.
When somebody was short on the ticket, you know, something like that, they did something wrong, wrecking crew come and get them.
That's common sense, man. If you fucked up, you got fucked up, period.
Wrecking crew is, if they see cats not from over here, or cats then took something, ran off with some money, or, you know what I'm saying, it's just bow, they got the brakes beat off of them by the wrecking crew, you know what I'm saying? And the wrecking crew, when they came with their little baseball bats and whatnot, they wasn't for no games.
They was coming to wreck you. It wasn't gonna be no talking. You leaving out of there to EMS. So I'm setting an example. I came and I tried to do it peacefully. You didn't want it like that.
Took care of your business. Did what you had to do, you got paid. But if you fucked money up and didn't do what you were supposed to do, then you got dealt with it. You know, that was a game.
See, back in the day, you can owe a nigga $20, cuz. It was a wrap, period.
Where your people at? Because right now we got to hire this. Red Nuggets have you. You got to have your team when you get that money. If you ain't got no team, man, you you make no money. But if you ain't got a team, man, we'll take your spot, see what I'm saying, and get your money. See what I'm saying? So you both.
That's it, man. You don't be in a hospital. You don't be in a hospital.
Welcome to the ghetto. 7 o'clock on a warm evening in March, and you are riding in a caravan of unmarked police cars about to raid what they call a major distribution outlet of heroin in the Brewster Housing Project. The assault on the apartment comes fast.
Ain't nothing for you to see in here, you understand? So just keep your head right there. Don't look around or talk.
Police say they found what appears to be heroin with a street value of about $4,000. Police tell me some of the heroin would be sold to other drug dealers in the project, and some would be given to kids to sell on the street. The place, police say, is a suspected dope house in the Young Boys Incorporated network. All in all, five people are put under arrest, and police call it a small victory in a war they themselves admit they are losing. Raiding by day and by night has hardly put a dent in the heroin trafficking on the street. By the time it reaches this level, police say it's just too late.
Arrest 16 people all at one time over in the Jeffries Projects. 15 minutes after we take them downtown, there's another 25 or 30 runners out there dealing dope. That doesn't sound like we're winning to me.
If the battle against youngsters selling heroin is being lost, then surely juvenile court is Waterloo. Last year, 1981, police in Detroit say they arrested about 1,000 youngsters under 17 for drug offenses. But of those 1,000 kids put under arrest, only about 250 were actually charged in juvenile court. Of them, only about 125 were found guilty. And of those found guilty, almost half received probation.
They found a new wrinkle. When I say they, I'm talking about the bad guys. They found a new wrinkle. They found a way to use the system to beat the system.
I start hearing certain things on the news and in the newspaper about him, and I was like, this can't be the same guy that I knew.
They were the biggest drug organization that Detroit has ever seen. Anytime the president's wife want to come and worry about something that happened in Detroit, you know it was big.
Fuck New Jack City. We was the first New Jack City. You know what I'm saying? We used to have the building boarded up, nailed down. Took the police months to get up in that motherfucker, man. Took them months, 6 months, 7 months. They could never come up in there unless we let whoever in that we felt we need to let in. As far as the police, they couldn't even get in this bar. It was like a fortress, man.
We had a classic saying that if they thought they saw a scout car, a marked car, or an unmarked unit, they would say off the hook, 5-0's in the hood. And that would be a general trend that you, phrase that you would hear throughout the city. And they literally took over. That was the precursor for street sales in the United States. It originated here in Detroit.
Also, you know, we used to get pulled over. Police harass me, take my money out of my pocket, throw it all on the floor. I mean, on the ground, you know, rough me up, you know, and then they try to interrogate me, of course, you know. But, hey, all I could tell them was, my lawyer is Otis Culpepper. That's it. Try to get me to say something that I seen him, I seen something, all that kind of stuff. And I ain't never seen none of that stuff.
It was a store right here. I pulled up. Instead of me going to my house, I pulled up at the store, and the police pulled up on me, caught me with a bird right there, whole key, 20,000 cash and a pistol. Caught my first case right there, my first big case right there, with them guys standing there.
Every day, the police was trying to bust me. So if I knew they was going to come on Monterey today, even if they was on Monterey, I'd say, when they come, y'all set up on Duane. While they over here, I would be on another street, slanging, you know, while we watching them.
So in the cat and mouse game, you were winning at this time.
Yes.
And that was as much a rush as anything else.
Oh, man, you couldn't get no higher than that. You know, not only was I beating them, I'm getting money, you know, and I'm saying, and I'm showing them, y'all can't catch me.
Although the Detroit police worked overtime to stop Young Boys Incorporated, Jones continued to elude local authorities. It took cooperation between the Detroit Police Department and federal agencies, primarily the DEA, to stop Jones.
On the 24-hour arrest report, you would see the same adults and juvenile names over and over again, and you started to see a pattern there. So what it took was a collaborative effort from our department, our narcotics division and DEA, and we sat down and said, hey, look, there's more to this case than what this organization than what we really thought.
How do you put together a drug enterprise with that level of organization and kind of innovation? You are the man who basically wrote the modern textbook on urban drug running. Really, aren't you?
Well, my input, my attributes to the organization was that I knew how things go. You know, I knew the rules, you know, and they was looking for direction. They needed somebody to tell them the rules. And the rules was, you know, if you're going to slang, you can't do no telling. It's part of the police job to stop, rash you, pick you, or bust you if they can. You see what I'm saying? It's nothing personal with them. They doing what the taxpayers is paying them to do.
You know, we were really fighting several different fronts, so, you know, that something had to break. So, and we could not have done it without the effort with the feds, because they had the extra tools to help us. Young Boys became so sophisticated that we did have to rely upon not just information and search warrants, we did have to rely on federal wiretaps in order to break them.
In December 1982, Jones and 40 other alleged upper and middle-level YBI employees were indicted by a federal grand jury. Jones escaped arrest until March 22, 1983, when he turned himself into federal authorities. After running an operation that grossed an estimated $35 million and employed nearly 1,000 people, Jones served 9.5 years of a 12-year sentence.
Mr. Jones indicates that he was never caught doing anything wrong, which is one of the main reasons they could never catch him for so many years. The organization flourished from 1978 to 1982. And even then, they couldn't catch him. He had to turn himself in to be caught. And that was because the government had to come up with a law to catch him, running a continual criminal enterprise. Your response?
Well, I mean, my response is simple. Mr. Jones is living in a fantasy world. He was convicted of a very serious federal narcotics offense, operating a continuing criminal enterprise, which basically says he survived in a leadership position, amassing a fortune selling narcotics on the streets of this city.
The nature of a criminal or ex-con like Butch Jones? Friend or foe?
Foe. I mean, the most successful of ex-cons, again, they're usually intelligent, they're very charismatic, they have good people skills, and they do a lot of things to shield outright illegal activity from somebody pointing a finger at them. They do not tolerate people cooperating with law enforcement, and if they get a hint that somebody's going to cooperate with law enforcement, they'll go and execute that person. But they're not going to present themselves and project themselves as an executioner, because everybody will be turned off at that. They want to be able to go in and go to the crowd and slap everybody five and say the latest saying, so they're part of the group and build up that trust and that honor and that respect, but it's all phony.
Butch Jones is sent to jail. Finally, he gets out. Now he has a book that does not have in it a repentant tone anywhere, realistically. This man can effectively be a role model selling a story about his criminal exploits. And should he be allowed to do that?
One, I have, from a personal perspective, I really can't see how any young person in this city or anywhere can look to someone like that as a role model.
Should someone like Butch Jones, an extraordinary criminal, be allowed to profit from their criminal exploits by retelling their stories?
Let me turn it around just briefly. Let's ask the victims, the people that were murdered by young boys, by their wrecking crew. Let's ask the people who became addicted. Let's ask the young women who wound up selling their bodies for heroin, or turning tricks, or doing what they whatever young boys wanted them to do. Let's ask them how they feel about this guy profiting from, or anyone for that matter, profiting from their books.
The issue was raised, Butch, by some in the law enforcement community and other circles, that they're appalled that you have a book out there now and actually making money legitimately off the story of your drug dealing past. What's your response to that?
It's basically is that I paid my debt to society, first of all. And second of all, my book is information. People is buying my book because of what I've been through in life. I'm not trying to justify, glorify selling drugs or nothing like this. I'm just saying that it's wrong, and I'm saying now why it's wrong.
To other folks, they're going to be on the fence. They're going to be like, you know, people can change.
Well,
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then some folks are going to say, I don't believe them.
You can't do nothing about that. You know, no matter how good a person try to do or whatever, you always got opposition.
What do you personally regret most about that whole episode in your life at this time?
Well, I regret that the people that I had to shoot. I regret the people that I was selling heroin to, as far as messing their life up or whatever role I played in. A lot of people, mind you, a lot of people that bought heroin for me was older than me. You know, they was doing heroin way before I came about, but it was still wrong. It was still part of a mass genocide that I didn't know about at that particular time.
Tell me this, if Butch Jones could do it again and get away with it, would you?
No. It ain't no getting away. You can't fool yourself. That's what I'm trying to tell you. It ain't no doing it, getting away with it. You just fooling yourself. You do it, get away with it for a minute, and you live that life. I lived the American dream. I lived in the best houses, ate the best food, and been all over the world like a globetrotter. That's nothing.
That is precisely the reason a young person might not listen. Because Butch Jones made millions. Butch Jones made sure others made millions. Butch Jones got paid, they got paid. Butch Jones lived to tell the story. I can live to tell the story.
Yeah, but see, I ain't paid my dues. I got 16 years of being incarcerated. See, that's, you gotta look at the downside of that. Is it worth it? Are you willing to spend 16 years out your life? Or not? You may not spend 16 years. You may do life, or better yet, you might get killed.
ghetto gospel.
I welcome with my hands, and the red sun sings at last into the hills of gold. A peace to this young warrior without the sound of guns.
Absolutely, he definitely had that leader mentality, regardless of whether it was street or whether it was about business. At that point, his thing he believed in, you could control what you did far better than somebody else in controlling what you did.
When he speak, he's serious. That's how he raised me, you know. So if he do something wrong, then he know how I'ma feel because he trained me to be that way, you know.
I've seen the man come out of his pocket to a person that he don't even know and say, here, I know this much. He had a chance to get out here. I bet he'd make it right. I bet you that. You know.
Lord, can you hear me speak?
Well, basically, I would like the people to know, man, you know, I've been a thorough dude all my life. And I'm always thorough, but if I had to give it all back, I would rather get my education, stay in school, because, you know, the people that get up and go to work every day, man, that's the real hard job, to get up, go punch a clock, and do a 9-to-5, man. You know, some drugs ain't nothing, man. You know, you keep it real, man. These people ain't playing. They got these prisons all over, and they say it's about locking people up, man. And a dude need to get their education and stay in school, because once you get your education, you can write your own check in life and be anybody you want to be. You know, drugs is not the only option for us. There's a lot of legit stuff that that we can do. And, you know, and if I could change one person's life, I felt like I would, you know, I'd be and did something good, man, because so much talent you see in jail, man. People in jail, they can do everything in the world. I promise you, man, it's a lot of talent in here. If these guys were given another opportunity to be on the streets and do something positive, a lot of these guys will never come back to jail because they're going to do something good with their life, man. But it's just so hard on guys in prison because people, once we go to jail, people forget about us, man. They think it's over for us, and it's not like that.
Ghetto gospel. Those who wish to follow me,
my ghetto gospel,
I welcome with my hands. And the red sun sings at last into the hills of gold. A peace to this young warrior without the sound of guns.
My ghetto gospel.